prove a theorem. If a sequence converges to a number, then we have to show that that number is unique. The statement of the theorem is, if a sequence AN converges to a real number L, then we have to show that that real number L is unique. For this, we will recall the definition of convergent sequence. We know that a sequence AN converges to L if for a given epsilon, which is positive, there exists a natural number M such that modulus of AN minus L is less than epsilon for all N is greater than or equals to M. Or we can define in terms of limits. If the limit of the sequence whose nth term, namely AN, as N tends to infinity is L, then we say that the sequence AN converges to L, or we say AN is convergent. This is the definition of convergent. Then what do you mean by unique? Unique, the meaning of unique is exactly one and only one. That is, there is only one element that satisfies a certain condition. Now, we have to show that there is only one L which satisfies this condition. How do you prove that L is unique? In general, in mathematics, whenever you want to prove uniqueness, we always consider two such elements. Here, we are given that the sequence converges to L. So, we consider L1 and L2 be two such elements. To show it is unique, first, that is, we have to show that L1 is equal to L2 for uniqueness. But normally, what do? We first assume that L1 is not equal to L2. And we'll proceed. While we are proceeding, we will get a contradiction. Why this contradiction arises? Because what we have assumed in the beginning is not correct. Therefore, what we have to do? We have to change our assumption. Since we assumed L1 is not equal to L2, now we have to change our assumption. That is, L1 is equal to L2. That is, L1, the two such elements, L1 and L2, are not different. Both are one and the same. This is how we will prove uniqueness. Let us prove the theorem now. The statement is, if a sequence AN converges to L, then it is unique. See, whenever you want to prove a theorem or want to do a problem, solve your problem, first of all, we should know what is given. That is the hypothesis. And we should know what is to be proved. To prove that, what are the things we have to use? That's very important. So, what is given here? We are given here, the sequence AN converges to L. This is given. What do you have to prove? We have to show that this L is unique. For this, as I told you, we are going to consider two such elements. Here we are taken, the two elements are L and L dash. See here, we assumed here L is not equal to L dash. This is our assumption. Be two limits of the sequence AN such that, see, whenever you take two elements, there are three possibilities. One of the number is, suppose A and B are two elements, we consider the two real numbers, we have three possibilities. That is, A is greater than B, or A is less than B or A equals to B, and this is known as law of trichotomy. But since here L and L dash are the real numbers, since we assume the L is not equals to L dash, we have two more possibilities. What are the two more possibilities? Either L is greater than L dash or L dash is greater than L. Now here we assume that L is greater than L dash. This implies L minus L dash is positive. Now, what is epsilon? In the definition of convergent sequence, epsilon is very, very small. But what's the condition? It must be positive. Since L minus L dash is greater than 0, we take modulus whose value is greater than 0. We are going to consider epsilon is L minus L dash. So epsilon is equal to modulus of L minus L dash is greater than 0. We can even need not take L minus modulus here, because since we assume the L is greater than L dash, we need not write. But even if you write, nothing wrong in it. Nothing wrong in it. When you say modulus of L minus L dash is greater than 0, the only possibility is L is not equal to L dash. Now this is very important. The contradiction lies on this epsilon, whose value is modulus of L minus L dash. Now what's the definition? It is given that the sequence AN converges to L. Then by the definition of sequence, the sequence AN converges to L, then by definition, first of all, what will be given? We should be given epsilon. For that epsilon, we find natural number small m. Therefore, epsilon is greater than 0. There x is m1. See here, normally we write m, but here we have written m1. Why we are using m1 here? Because there are two limits, L and L dash. Therefore, we use m1 and m2 here. So, for the given epsilon, there x is m1 belongs to n, such that modulus of an minus L is less than epsilon by 2. And you can see here, generally we write an minus L is less than epsilon. But here we have written epsilon by 2. Why we have written epsilon by 2? I tell you later on. Another thing is, which is correct, because whenever the epsilon is positive, epsilon by 2 is also positive, which is smaller than epsilon. It is true for all n is greater than or equals to m1. This is for L. Similarly, since we assumed that a sequence an converges to L dash also, so we have to write again, by our assumption, a supposition, the sequence, the same sequence, AN converges to L dash. By the definition, for the same epsilon, you should not change epsilon, because the sequence is same sequence. The sequences are different, we can choose different epsilon. Since the sequence is the same sequence, we have to choose the same epsilon. Same epsilon greater than 0. Here m1 belongs to n. Here we take m2 belongs to n. See here, m1 and m2 belongs to n, such that modulus of an minus L dash is less than epsilon by 2 for all n is greater than or equals to m2. Now, there are two m's. What we do? We have to choose the minimum of these two or maximum of these two. But here, we choose maximum. Why we choose maximum? Here, we have taken m equal to maximum of m1, m2. Why we have written maximum? Because when you take maximum, it satisfies all the conditions. It satisfies all the conditions. That's why we take M1 out of M1 and M2, whichever is the larger value that we take. Now start up. These are all nothing but the data which is given and which is to be proved. Now the actual theorem starts. Consider modulus of L minus L dash. As I told you, this only is going to give contradiction. Now consider this. L minus L dash. Now we are going to add and subtract AN here. The value will not change. We add and subtract. Now, this can be grouped. L minus AN plus AN minus L dash. Also, we know that if x and y are real numbers, then modulus of x plus y is always less than or equal to mod x plus mod y, the triangular inequality which we learned already. So if you consider L minus AN as x, AN minus L dash is y, then what happened? The modulus of x plus y is less than or equals to, see the inequality here. Here equal here, inequality changes because modulus of x plus y is less than or equals to modulus of x modulus of y. Therefore, we use the triangle inequality here and hence we get less than or equals to. That is, modulus of L minus L dash is equal. Now what happened? Less than or equal. Therefore, modulus of L minus L dash is less than or equals to, here, modulus of L minus AN. But what is written here? We written AN minus L. Nothing wrong in it, because we also know that modulus of A minus B is same as modulus of B minus A, because modulus of negative value is positive. And hence, L minus AN, we write it as AN minus L plus AN minus L dash. Now, what is the value of modulus of AN minus L? In the previous slide, since L is a limit of your sequence AN, we have chosen epsilon and epsilon that exists M1 such that we wrote modulus of AN minus L is less than epsilon by 2. Similarly, modulus of AN minus L dash is also less than epsilon by 2. And hence, the next step, look at this next step. This less than or equals to become strictly less than. The reason is modulus of AN minus L is strictly less than epsilon by 2. Similarly, modulus of AN minus L dash is also strictly less than epsilon by 2. That's why this less than or equal to symbol becomes less than symbol. Then what is epsilon by 2 plus epsilon by 2? Which is epsilon? What is epsilon? We already assumed the beginning epsilon equal to modulus of L minus L dash. Now what happens here? If you start with L minus L dash, which is less than L minus L dash. See here, next step. Modulus of L minus L dash is less than modulus of L minus L dash. Is it true? Can you say modulus of 5 is less than modulus of 5? Can you say modulus of 8 is less than modulus of 8? Never. Never. So this is a contradiction. This is a absurd. A contradiction. Why these contradictions arise? Because in the beginning, we assumed that L is not equals to L dash. Therefore, our supposition is wrong. That is, our supposition, namely, L minus L dash is wrong. Hence, L is equal to L dash. That is, the limit is unique. This is the proof of this theorem. See, for example, let us take one example. I know NCP7 is Praveen. Who is NCP7? That is L. Who is Praveen? L dash. We know that NPC7 is Praveen. NPC7 is nothing but Praveen. Suppose when I ask the student of NPC section, if we ask anybody who is NCP7, they say Praveen. If you consider this is L dash, what happened? They are one and the same. So it's true for each and every student of ALC. Your name is exactly same as your register number. Generally, we don't call your name. Normally, we call the number so that we can say some time. And hence, they are equal. Similarly, here, L is equal to L dash. This is how we prove the uniqueness of the limit. Thus, the statement says that, the theorem says that, if a sequence converges to a real number, then the real number is unique. Let us prove another theorem. Every convergent sequence is bounded. We already learned the definition of convergent sequence. We also know the bounded sequence definition. If you recall both, then the proof of this theorem will be very easy. Let us recall the theorem. Definition of convergent sequence. A sequence AN converges to a real number L if for a given epsilon there exists M belongs to N such that modulus of AN minus L less than epsilon for all N is greater than or equal to M. Or when you remove the modulus, we can write L minus epsilon less than AN less than L plus epsilon. It is true for all N is greater than M. That is, this is true from mth term onwards. That is, from the mth term onwards, all the terms of the sequence AN must be between the value L minus epsilon and L plus epsilon. This is the definition of convergent sequence. When do you say a sequence is bounded? We say a sequence AN is said to be bounded if it is both bounded above and bounded below. That is, there exist two real numbers. Normally we take L1, L2, but in this theorem, I am going to take K1, K2. Therefore, let us choose K1, K2 belong to R such that K1 is less than or equals to AN less or equals to K2 for all N belong to N. Now, you see, what you have to prove? This is given. What is given? L minus epsilon less than AN less than L plus epsilon is given. But we have to show that from this, we must get this one. Which one? K1 less than or equals to AN less than or equal to K2 with the help of the definition of convergent sequence and this condition. But another thing is, we are going to derive this inequality, this inequality k1 less than or equal to an less than or equal to k2 from the inequality minus epsilon less than an less than l plus epsilon. And we have to see one more condition, one more thing. In the first one, it is given that for all n is greater than or equal to m, it means this inequality is true from mth term onwards. When it comes to boundedness, it must be true right from the first term. That is, every term in the sequence must satisfy the condition, namely k1 less than or equal to an less than or equal to k2. Therefore, there are two things. One is minus l minus epsilon less than an less than l plus epsilon should be changed into k1 less than or equal to an less than or equal to k2. At the same time, this condition should be extended to every natural number. That's why I highlighted these two. Okay, let us prove the theorem now. Every convergent sequence is bounded. As I told you, first of all, we should mention what is given. What is given here? Sequence an converges to some number l. Consider some number l. What you have to prove? The sequence an is bounded. Since we know both definitions, convergence as well as boundedness, use these two to get the or to prove the theorem. Now, what is given? An converges to L. Since An converges to L, by definition, we have to say flow should come. For a given epsilon, there exists M such that, it should come now. A given epsilon between 0, there exists M belongs to N such that modulus of An minus L is less than epsilon. It is true for all N is greater than or equals to M. When you remove this modulus, what happened? We get minus epsilon less than or equal to an minus l less than epsilon. When you add l, what do you get? Here we get l minus epsilon. Here an minus l plus l. Minus l plus l get cancelled. So an less than l plus epsilon for all n is greater than or equal to m. This is given. This is nothing but definition of convergent sequence. Now, what you have to prove? We have to show that this an is lying between two real numbers and it should be true for every term of the sequence. Now, as we discussed in the previous slide, we have to choose k1, k2. K1, k2 are two real numbers. We are going to choose. Let k1 be a1, a2, a3, am minus 1, comma l minus epsilon. K2 be a1, a2, a3, am minus 1, comma l plus epsilon. See, the k1 takes any value from a1 to l minus epsilon. K2 takes any value from a1 to l plus epsilon. Why we consider this a1, a2, a3, am minus 1? Because we are going to show that k1 is less than or equal to an for all n. For all n. For that sake only, we take k1 as a1, a2, a3, so on. Similarly here, k2, a1 to a minus 1. See, in the inequality one, here, all these terms are missing. A1 is missing, A2 missing, A3 missing, AM minus 1 missing. But AM is there, AM plus 1 is there. So from mth term onwards, everything is there. What are the missing terms? A1, A2, A3, AM minus 1. Therefore, we take K1B, the set a1, a2, a3, am minus 1, k2 be a1, a2, a3, am minus 1 comma L plus epsilon with the choice of K1 and K2. The choice of K1 and K2, this 1 becomes, they are right, K1 less than or equal to An less than or equal to K2, because we consider K1, K2 are starting from A1 to M minus 1. Therefore, what is N here? N is for all N belongs to N. For all N belong to N. Because it includes A1, A2, A3, AM minus 1, AM, AM plus 1, AM plus 2. That is every term in the sequence. What does it mean? K1 less than or equal to An less than or equal to K2. It means the sequence An is bounded because this is the lower bound, this is the upper bound. And hence, the sequence An is bounded. It's a very simple definition, simple theorem. Simply, we apply the definition of convergent, then choose K1, K2, that's enough. But while writing K1, K2, we should be very cautious. We have to write all the missing terms in the inequality 1. The missing terms are A1 to A minus 1. So this proves the theorem. See, every theorem, for every theorem, the converse need not be true. The converse need not be true. Similarly here, the converse of the above theorem is not true. What do you mean by converse? What do you mean by converse? When you say converse, we say normally it's not true. But when you write the statement of the converse, we have to write every bounded sequence need not be. See, that is very important. When you write the statement, we say is not true. Is not true. The converse is not true. But when you write its statement, we should not write every bounded sequence is not convergent. What do you have to write? We have to write need not be converged. Because there are some cases, some bounded sequence may converge. May converge. Therefore, whenever we write the statement of the converse, we have to write need not be. That statement must be written. We have to highlight that. Need not converge. We'll consider an example. Every bounded sequence need not converge. It's a well-known example. As I told you already in the very beginning of the class, or in the beginning of the semester, the sequence namely An, whose nth term is minus 1 power n, is a well-known example. Very often we discuss here also. Whenever you give a converse of the statement, when you say the converse is not true, we have to prove it. That is called justification. For justification, we take one example and we show that that example does not satisfy the statement. Now consider the justification is, consider sequence An defined by An is equal to minus 1 power n. We know that the sequence An consists of terms minus 1 plus 1 minus 1 plus 1 so on. And the values of An is between minus 1 and 1 inclusive of 1 and minus 1. That is the one we write. Or we can write minus 1 less than or equal to An less than or equal to 1. What does it mean? This means the sequence An is bounded. The sequence An is bounded. See here, the sequence An is bounded. Now what do you do? We have to show that it is not convergent. It is not convergent. We already discussed while discussing about the oscillating sequence. We have taken this example as the oscillating sequence. So clearly, same thing we write. minus 1 less than equal to an less than equal to 1. This is bounded but not convergent because it is oscillating sequence. It oscillates between minus 1 and plus 1. Minus 1 and plus 1. See, minus 1 plus 1, minus 1 plus 1, minus 1 plus 1. So it oscillates between minus 1 and plus 1. Therefore, this is an example which contradicts the statement every bounded sequence converges. I'll give one more example. Suppose, let me do the same example. See, all NCP or NPC students are Lyolites. All NPC students or NMC students or NEM students. These are three sections I am handling this semester. So, consider all NEM section students are Lyolite. What's the converse? All Lyolites are NEC students? No. That is not correct. So the converse is not true here. The converse is not true. We give the statement, all NEC students are Lyolite. It's a statement. What's the converse? All Lyolites are NEC students. Is it true? No. Suppose NPC 7, Praveen. Praveen is a Lyolite. Does he belong to NEC section? No. So this is a very best example for the converse part. Now, we are going to discuss another theorem. What is this theorem? Can you name the theorem? If you see the picture, you can name it immediately. That is known as sandwich theorem.